Obviously, this topic that you've given me to reflect on is an overwhelming topic to try to cover in one lecture. And I obviously also feel very presumptuous seeking to tell you what the challenges you face are when I've only been in this country for a week. That does seem, at the very least, presumption, and I hope it isn't arrogant. But you gave me the topic, so I will do my best. I did come here once before in the 1980s. So I was here to teach in Auckland and in Christchurch and in Wellington. What I thought I would do is just choose a small number of the multitude of issues that we could address, try to focus on some of the most significant ones. Some I'm going to speak about just very briefly. Others I will speak about at more length, and then try to make sure we've got a good bit of time at the end for you to ask questions if you want me to develop the ones I cover very briefly, or if you would like to raise something completely different that I didn't address at all. And please feel free to do that in the question time. I spent much of my life working in Le Brie with Francis Schaeffer, and the kind of ground rule of operation is we are confident that God's word is the truth, that Christianity is the only truth, and that therefore you are free to ask any questions, to express any doubts, to raise any problems, and we won't be upset if you do. We won't be offended. So it's important to bring our questions out into the open. My new sister, well, of course, she's not new. I mean, she's been my sister all this time. Neither of us knew the other existed. But she spoke to one of her sons has become a believer. He lives in Australia. And she met with his pastor. And she has lots of questions she's really seeking. And he just refused to answer her questions. He just basically said, repent and believe, and just forget those questions. Well, that's not how God's word speaks to us. That's not how you see Jesus relating to people. That's not how God himself deals with us. We all come to him every day with doubts and struggles and questions and needs, and he doesn't rebuke us. He welcomes us. And encourages us to open our hearts to him. That's why the Bible has books like the book of Job and the book of Lamentations in it, and psalms of lament, psalms of question, psalms of complaint, because God delights in us opening our hearts to him and telling him what is truly there. So right at the beginning, I want to say to you, please feel free to ask me whatever you want at the end, and I won't be offended. So what are some of the particular challenges that face us? I think nothing I say is going to be new to you, but I want to focus on just a few things. The first is simply this. We live in a cultural setting where there is a loss of objective truth. And what has replaced the conviction that there is one truth which explains who we are, which tells us what the human condition is, what our problems are, and what the resolution to those is. What has replaced that, and there was a conviction in all the world that was either Western or influenced by the ideas of the West, for many hundreds of years, the basic conviction was whether people accepted it or not, whether they bowed before God or not, people recognized that Christianity was claiming to be objectively true, the true account of the human condition, of who God is, who we are, our problems, and the resolution of the past and the future, what lies before us, both in this world and in eternity to come. But there is a complete loss in our cultures of that conviction, either that Christianity is objectively true or that there is any objective truth that can be discovered or known. Instead, there is simply personal opinion, personal conviction, personal commitments. For the whole generation of people under 30, I think for almost all of them, it doesn't even enter their minds that there is the possibility of truth. I'll never forget being interviewed right after I moved to St. Louis to start teaching at Covenant, and this was at the beginning of 1989, and just after I got there, so 23 years ago, I was interviewed on one of the major television channels there by the anchor. I think it was on NBC, and was on this program, and there was a panel of people, and when she came to me, she asked me a question, and I made the statement that I believed Christianity was objectively true, that it was the truth about the universe in which we live and about who we are. And she was completely astonished. I saw her raise her eyebrows, and not in disgust, but just amazement. And she said to me afterwards, I've never, this is a very educated woman in her 40s, and she said, I have never in my life heard anybody say anything like that before. And she said, my view of Christianity, and this is the view of everybody I know and of all churches, is that going to church is just like going to different restaurants. You know, one evening I might have Vietnamese food, and another evening I might have Italian food, and another evening I might go and have American hamburgers. You know, it's just a matter of choice, what I feel like at the moment. And that's how I've thought about church. I might go to a Presbyterian church one day, or a Baptist church, or an Episcopal church, an Anglican church, a Catholic church, a Jewish synagogue, the Humanist Ethical Society, or whatever it may be, and it's just, I go because that's what I feel like doing. But I often go, she said, to church or some kind of religious service, but never in my life have I ever heard a pastor say that what he's preaching about, what he's teaching about, is the truth about the world in which we live. And so while she didn't resist what I was saying, she was completely astonished by it. That's the first challenge we face. You have to understand that's the context in which we live. And it gives us particular challenges as we try to make God's word known. Because just like that woman, people don't hear us making truth claims unless we speak with very great care. They just hear religious noises. That's what they hear. You know, it's, if I can use an example, whenever I go to our symphony in St. Louis, and we have a wonderful symphony, and we'll go to hear Haydn's Creation, which is one of my favorite pieces of music, or Handel's Messiah, I look around at the 1,000 people or more who are there, and most of them have no thought whatsoever that either Haydn or Handel are telling the truth in the Messiah or in the Creation. You know, they hear these wonderful arias and choruses about the birth of Christ and the death of Christ and the resurrection of Christ and the second coming of Christ, or these wonderful songs about the creation of this universe and of Adam and Eve. And they're not thinking about it as truth, they're thinking about it as this beautiful music and this wonderful set of religious ideas which move them very deeply, but which they don't pay attention to as truth claims. And that is how most people are who come to church, including evangelical churches. They're not hearing truth claims. They're hearing music. They're hearing religiously moving themes, psalms, songs, prayers. But they're not hearing truth claims unless you speak with very great care. So that's the first challenge that we face. The second is this. There is the passionate belief that I have the right to think as I wish about God, about whether God exists or not, about whether that matters, about human life, about the meaning and purpose of human life. Now, that is the second problem. It goes along with this idea that there is no objective truth. Instead, there is personal opinion, personal conviction. You've all seen television programs, heard radio programs, seen magazine articles in which various popular people are asked what they believe about God. And they give their personal opinion, and it tells you nothing about who God actually is, about what the truth is. You've just got all these people sharing their convictions, which they feel they have the absolute right to have. And the person who is writing the article feels the same way. It's just like that television anchor. It's just like going to different restaurants. There are all these different flavors out there. And this is my flavor at the moment. And you see many people going through many different religious phases in their life as they embrace something for a while because it meets some need in their heart or mind for a moment. But again, they've never thought about it as truth. They've simply thought about it as the right to these particular convictions, to these opinions, to embrace this idea for a moment. Now, what this means, and where this raises another challenge for us, is this. As long as people hear us simply speaking about Christianity as my personal faith, what gives me meaning and purpose, most people aren't upset at all. That's very nice for you. And when I became a Christian, at the age, I just had turned 21 a month before, my parents were delighted because before that I had been suicidal. I thought life was utterly absurd. I'd wanted to kill myself. And they were very glad. I didn't want to kill myself anymore. But they didn't think for a moment, it didn't enter their minds that I had really come to believe that Christianity was objectively true, and it took me a while to persuade them of that. For them, they were glad that I was going through this religious phase, that I had these religious convictions and faith. But they thought they would pass. You know, this was just something that was helping me for the moment. But the idea for them, and of course, my parents were from a much earlier generation, but this idea is not new in our culture. It's not just people under 30. You know, my dad died at the age of 75 in 1972, so this is back in the late 60s. My parents were responding that way back in England. You know, this is wonderful that you have these personal convictions, that you've got this personal faith, which has given you a sense of meaning. Yeah, we're so glad for you. But that's how they understood it. They didn't see it as anything else, and I had to work very hard at persuading them that no, Dad, no, Mum, I actually think this is true. And that's why I don't want to kill myself anymore, because I have become persuaded that there is a God who created this world and that He has made us to serve Him, and we've rebelled against Him. And we need the forgiveness that is offered to us in Jesus and all the other basics of a Christian understanding of reality that God has told us in His Word. But now, as long, for most people around us, as long as they think that Christianity is simply my personal opinion, my personal faith, they won't be too upset. But for many people around us, when they understand that we actually believe that Christianity is true, that it is the truth, they realize that what we're saying is that what other people believe is wrong. And then they are deeply offended. I remember being asked by the head of the upper school to go and speak at a school in St. Louis, a kind of grammar school there, to a group of kids who are about 15 years old, about 100 of them. And the man wasn't a Christian who invited me. He said, I'm having a series of religious guys come and talk about their faith and their practices to our students. And he said, I've had a Buddhist and I've had a Muslim and a Hindu and a Jew just a couple of weeks ago, and now you, I knew you from when your boys were here, so I thought it would be nice to ask you to come and speak, because we'd always got on well together. So he said, but please don't do what the Jewish rabbi did a couple of weeks ago, because he just talked about the different kinds of candles they used in various seminary ceremonies, and the kids were bored to death. And so what I did was to tell the story of how I became a Christian and the questions that I had had as an unbeliever, that the three questions I had struggled with, that I had gone to university with expecting to get answered. I'd worked for a year between grammar school and going off to Manchester University, and I wrestled with three questions that I'd come up with. I thought, I must have these answered. What is a human being? And is there any explanation for the wonderful things that are part of our lives? You know, I came from a family where my parents had the best marriage I've ever seen in my life. It's my inspiration to this day. But they were wonderful parents. They were passionately committed to mercy and generosity and hospitality and justice. These were non-Christians, by the way. And so I've seen many beautiful things, but I wanted to, where did these come from? Do they have any ultimate meaning? And my second question was, is there any difference ultimately between good and evil? Now, I love virtue, I love justice, I love mercy, I love the integrity of my parents. But in the end, does it matter? Is there ultimately a difference? And the third question I had was, why is there so much suffering in the world? And is there any answer to it? And I went to university expecting that those questions would get answered, and they weren't by any of my professors at all. They weren't interested even when I tried to ask them. And that's why I very quickly came to a position of complete despair, feeling life was utterly absurd, and went out one day to kill myself, to throw myself over a cliff outside of Manchester, and then was overwhelmed by the beauty of nature, even in the middle of winter on a very, very cold day. It was just above freezing, and there were no leaves on the trees, but as I stood on that cliff, just ready to step into space and plunge to my certain death, I was just overwhelmed. And I thought, I have to keep looking. There has to be a reason why this world is so beautiful. And a couple of weeks later, I met my first real Christian who had been profoundly influenced by Francis Schaeffer. He was a Canadian PhD student, and he answered my questions. And I told this story to these kids, these 15-year-old kids, and they were absolutely fascinated. And I made it very clear that I was saying that, you know, what stopped me wanting to kill myself was that I came to believe this was the truth. And the very first question one of the kids asked was, and I think he was Indian, and I think he probably had a Hindu background, because we know several Hindu families there in St. Louis that have sent their kids to that school. One family we've got very close to, whose son was very close to our middle son, and still is. And so this Hindu boy, his very first question was, are you really saying that you believe Christianity is the truth and other religions are not true? And I said, yes, that is what I'm saying. And then they went on to explain very carefully what I meant by that. I wasn't saying there was no truth at all, because God, through the work of His Holy Spirit, has left elements of truth in His kindness all over the world to draw people to Himself. But in the end, Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam, Judaism do not tell us the saving truth which will deliver us from our needs. Only Christianity does. It is the only way that people can be set free from the brokenness of their lives and delivered into fellowship with God. The Bible is absolutely clear about that. And the kids went absolutely silent. They were astonished to hear somebody making this claim. This wasn't a Christian school, it's a very secular school. And as a consequence of my saying that there, some of the kids were very, very interested. A dear friend of mine was teaching there at the time, who was a Christian, and after it, the meeting, they knew that this young man knew me. And so several teachers went up to him and said, where shall I start reading the Bible? This man talked about the book of Ecclesiastes, which is what God had used to draw me to Himself through my Canadian friend. Meaningless, meaningless, everything is meaningless, says the preacher. He read to me the first evening I met in his apartment with a group of people who gathered with him, and he had no idea where I was coming from. The Lord just led him to Ecclesiastes 1 and 2 that evening, and it just astonished me, because I thought the Bible was just fairy stories. And here was this statement from Ecclesiastes describing my condition. But as a consequence of my being there that morning and giving that talk about the truth of Christianity, the principal became so furious that several of the teachers and students were wanting to talk to this young man who was teaching there. And he was very wise about how he did it. One of his colleagues became a Christian. He had meetings mostly off campus, but he eventually lost his job. He got pushed out in a completely unethical manner. But she was just outraged. As soon as you make the claim that Christianity is true, it is deeply offensive to people. They think that you are being self-righteous, that you are being arrogant, that you are being imperialistic, or they'll throw at you some other term of abuse, which is intended to dismiss you as utterly unworthy of serious attention. So that's the second challenge we face, the difficulty of addressing the issue that it's not just my truth, my faith, but it is indeed objectively true. And trying to speak that in a way which is gracious, which is faithful, which isn't arrogant, but which is very careful. We're called, as Paul says, to speak the truth with love, to correct our opponents with gentleness, to have all of our words be gracious. Now, in such a setting as this, if you don't speak graciously, as this pastor of my sister's son utterly failed to speak graciously to her, people do not listen. They will just dismiss you as self-righteous and arrogant. It's already challenging enough that the truth itself is regarded as self-righteous and arrogant. But if you are self-righteous and arrogant and lacking in grace and gentleness and love when you make them, then you've lost utterly in this cultural setting. And of course, you've lost because you're being utterly disobedient to God Himself and to the nature of the gospel. That brings us to a third issue. Now, along with this loss of objective truth and this turn to just personal conviction, there is a very deep cynicism in our cultures, not just about truth, but about ultimate meaning, about final purpose, about hope for the future, either in this world or after death. We live in a deeply cynical and hopeless culture, because we live in a culture which has indeed lost the biblical story of creation, fall, redemption, and consummation. Or, as I said the other day, my colleagues and I have been discussing how to capture that sweep of biblical history. And what I've begun to say is the story of creation, or the kingdom established, the story of our rebellion and the curse, or what we could call the age-long war, the story of God's promise and preparation, or the hope for the king, the story of redemption accomplished, or the coming of the king, the story of redemption proclaimed and applied, or kingdom mission to the world, and the story of the consummation, that is the return of the king. Now, that's the biblical story. And however you want to set it out, whether you use my particular terms or those traditional ones of creation, fall, redemption, and consummation, you know, our cultures have lost that story. And consequently, they have lost meaning very deeply. We live in a world where there is no ultimate hope. This is the basic fact that lies behind the declining birth rates in every single European country. Those cultures have lost their hope in the future. A culture with no hope in the future does not have children. And every European culture is losing its population, and that leads, of course, to all kinds of desperate economic problems and many, many other issues. It's one of the fundamental issues behind how deeply the recession is biting in Europe at the moment. But behind that is this loss of hope. A culture which cannot have enough hope in the future that to even have children to replace itself and to carry its culture on into the future is a dying culture. We're not far from that in North America. We're just about at the rate of 2.1. And I imagine it's the same here in New Zealand and Australia as well. And the only thing that's keeping us up there in the United States is a high rate of immigration, both legal and illegal. But we ourselves, by ourselves, are certainly not keeping pace. Now, that brings us to point number four. So, point number three, the desperate need to proclaim the biblical story and to proclaim it as truth. You know, there is this wonderful story which makes sense of our life and gives us hope and meaning, hope for the future and meaning for the present. But number four, perhaps the greatest problem of all that we face, is the fundamental idolatries of the cultural context in which we live. In one of his letters, the Apostle Paul writes about the characteristics of the last days, in which he says men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of pleasure, and lovers of money, rather than lovers of God. Now, these words describe our time and our setting. I'm not making some claim about when the second coming is by saying that, but they simply describe our time. The central idol of almost everyone around us. In America, the most deeply held conviction by 98% of the population It said, I am in charge of my own life. And I have the right to be. It's the most passionately, most widely, most deeply held conviction in the culture. And that's a cultural setting in which between 20 and 30% of the people claim to be born again Christians. But still 98% of the people are saying, I am in charge of my life and my destiny and my choices. Now, that central idol of almost everybody around us, and of our own hearts too, is personal autonomy. That is, that I am a law to myself. The belief that I am in charge of my own life, the assumption that I have the right to do whatever I wish with my body, with my sexuality, with my time, with my money, with every part of my life. The belief that I can define life for myself and I can choose my own truth, my own purpose, my own meaning, my own values. Well, people around us consider it absurd and immoral to challenge this core belief. You are considered immoral if you challenge that and say, no, you don't have the right to choose your own values. God has said, and you must bow to that. This is the way to live. And there is no other. That is considered an immoral claim in our cultural setting, and absurd. Now, this clearly makes the proclamation of the gospel very, very challenging. Because if we proclaim God's word faithfully and clearly into this setting, it will cut into the very heart of our time. It cuts into the very core of our cultural convictions and obsessions. And I will tell you, I don't think most churches ever really attack it, because it's very costly to challenge it. But if you don't challenge it, you know, there was this play, or this novel rather, about Martin Luther that was written in the 19th century, in which Luther is said to have proclaimed, and we don't know whether he ever did this, make this claim, but some of you will have heard the claim, but it actually comes from a 19th century novel, that if I preach the gospel in the loudest voice and in the clearest manner, at every point except where it is currently under attack, I haven't preached it at all. And I will tell you, if we don't preach the gospel against the idol of cultural personal autonomy, we are not preaching the gospel at all in this cultural setting. It doesn't matter how clearly we say anything else. If we don't challenge that, which is actually the devotion of the heart of almost everybody around us, we are not proclaiming the gospel of Christ in our generation. Now, that brings me to a fifth point, and it's related to that fourth one. In addition to the difficulties of communicating the truth of God into the wider cultural setting, there are very particular problems in the life of our churches that arise from this. Every week of my life, for years now, I will hear from friends, from pastors, how in almost every church, and I'm sure it's the same here in New Zealand as it is in the United States and in Britain, that some of those who appear to be most spiritual, most godly, most mature in their faith will suddenly leave their spouses and their children and reconnect with a flame and go off to live with them, somebody they'd reconnected with on Facebook who they knew years ago, or some new person that they've met. And they go off with this person, imagining that this is going to make them happier. Just this morning, early, I received an email today from a woman who considers herself a godly woman. She is the daughter of two of the most gracious and faithful parents I have ever met. The one a seminary professor all his life, just a wonderful man. The other, the wife, a university lecturer, a very godly woman. This woman who wrote to me this morning has been married for 35 years to a godly man. But what she wrote to me to say was, I want to live my own life. I want to find my own way of fulfillment. It's time for me to stand on my own two feet. I haven't told my husband yet, he's in the ministry. But any day now, I'm going to leave him, she said, and disappear to the west coast of the United States to pursue my dreams. And she finished her letter with a prayer that God would continue to bless me and my ministry. She clearly considers that the choice she is about to make, which she has already made in her heart, is perfectly within her rights and will be completely acceptable to the Lord. And don't be surprised by this. Oh, all of our churches already face and will face more and more people making such choices and not believing that there is anything problematic with what they are doing. That's what the culture of personal autonomy means. I have the right to do what I want to do with my life, and nobody has any business telling me anything else. It's very profound. And everybody in this room, all of us, wrestle with this because it's the air we breathe in this cultural setting. And if you don't think you wrestle with it or you ever will, you don't know your own heart. You don't understand how deceitful it is and how desperately wicked you are. We all are. And how much we need the grace of God every day of our lives, and how necessary it is that we humble ourselves before Him moment by moment and say, Lord, reveal to me my secret sins, reveal to me where this idol of our culture has entered my own heart. As Calvin said, our hearts are idol factories, but that idol is ready-made. And it's all around us, and it's already entered into us. And we need to be aware of it and to ask that the Lord will deliver us from it. It brings me to a sixth point. There's one other problem here I wish to address, and this applies to men in particular. One of the ways in which this idol of personal autonomy affects men is the deep reluctance in our cultural setting for men to be what God created them to be. That is, those who exercise dominion, those who are willing to assume responsibility under God for their work, for marriage, and for family. Now, all humans, male and female, are equally God's image, and all humans, male and female, are created to take dominion, to exercise responsibility and leadership, to use body, mind, will, emotion, and imagination to rule this world, and to live responsibly. Now, we live in a culture that, quite rightly, has encouraged women to take responsibility. That's a good thing. The church should always have been stressing that equality of persons and the dignity of women. And sometimes it has done, and sometimes it hasn't. Now, personal autonomy in this culture is a double-edged sword for women. In some ways, it has had a positive and encouraging impact, though it's also had devastating consequences, as with the example of the woman I used a few moments ago, who has really bought into the idol of personal autonomy, that I have the right to leave my husband, to go and live by myself and fulfill my dreams and do just exactly what I want to do, no matter the cost to anybody else, no matter what God thinks. However, on men, the idol of personal autonomy has had the impact of utterly undermining a sense of responsibility, the need to exercise dominion over one's life, the willingness to commit oneself to marriage and to family, the calling to be a faithful servant of others in all of life, a servant of the Lord and of our fellow human beings. Now, in the wider culture, this has dreadful consequences. In Japan, there's just a vast group of young men who just live at home, not working, not going to college, just watching pornography all day long and living off their parents. But the same is increasingly true in all of our cultures, of great numbers of young men who say it's for economic reasons but have moved back to their families because they don't really want to take responsibility for their own lives. It's much easier to live in somebody else's home, to have somebody else making the basic decisions, somebody else providing the meals, and all the basic needs of life. What it leads to in our churches, because it has a very profound impact on men not coming to Christian faith, on greater numbers of women than men in our churches, but also in our churches it leads to great numbers of younger women who would love to be married and have a family, but there is nobody there who is going to marry them and give them a family. It leads in the wider culture and also in the church to many men who postpone marriage or forgo it altogether, simply because marriage and family are really much too much like hard work. They demand commitment, responsibility, self-sacrifice, and foregoing instant gratification. There are many men who refuse, both outside the church and inside the church, who refuse to commit themselves to relationships but simply want sex with whoever and whenever. They are unwilling to give themselves to women, they're unwilling to give themselves to children, they're unwilling to give themselves to the church, to give the time, energy, and commitment are needed. Our culture has persuaded them that it is perfectly fine to live to please oneself. And there are vast numbers of young men in our culture, both outside and inside the church, who are living empty, shallow lives with goals that are utterly unworthy of our human calling. There are great numbers of men in our culture who are completely bored out of their heads. And not surprisingly so. The vast majority of men under 35 in our culture are deeply addicted to internet pornography, to casual sex, and whatever their particular personal interest happens to be. Interests that make no real life demands of them. Now, this is a challenging setting for us. And we need in this setting to teach discipleship with passion. But we need to give young men something to really live for. The gospel does. Jesus called his disciples to deny themselves, to take up their cross and to follow him. And we need to recover that call to radical discipleship in our churches. We need to teach God's law with passion as something beautiful, inspiring, and holy, something worth giving one's life to obey. We need to teach men to so love Jesus that they hunger and thirst for righteousness, that they're ready to abandon everything for him and to offer their lives to him, that he's worth giving everything for. And our churches have not proclaimed radical discipleship. They haven't proclaimed the beauty of God's law, the demands that God makes on us, this call to giving up everything and serving Christ and following him. But the New Testament is absolutely plain about it. That's where we've been so imbued by the cultural idol of personal fulfillment that we presented the gospel as if that's all it is. It's another way to be especially personally fulfilled. Well, of course it is. But if that is presented with that call to obedience and discipleship, it isn't a biblical gospel at all. That brings me to a point number 7, a final, just very brief point. And I feel even more presumptuous than about everything else to address this. But everybody talks to me about it, so I will. In addition to these other problems, here in New Zealand, there appears to be the local problem of what you call the tall poppy syndrome, which appears to have impacted your churches very profoundly. Anyone who stands up as an individual and says, "Here I stand, this is what is right." Anyone, including a pastor or seminary student, who does something slightly out of the ordinary is criticized for being arrogant or for imagining that he might be better than others, and why is he doing that? Anyone who proposes trying something new or different is treated with suspicion. This leads, of course, to a form of encouragement which is actually deeply discouraging, to damning people with faint praise. One young pastor told me this: the best praise he receives often on Sundays is, "Well, your sermon was better today than it was last week." Now, that really isn't encouragement at all. And he said, "I wanted to crawl into a hole when one of my elders said that to me." It wasn't encouraging. Of course it wasn't encouraging. And I want to challenge you on this one. Jesus encourages us. He delights in us. He cherishes us. He pronounces himself honored to know us. And we need to turn away from that whole thing and really take on board a biblical view of encouragement. Now, there are lots of things in our cultures we need to say, "Hold on." Now, this may shape what everybody thinks around us, but there's no need for me to be shaped by this as a believer. Jesus calls me to take every thought captive and make it obedient to Christ. And that includes the tall poppy syndrome as well. Amen. Amen. I will stop there. I've gone just about as long as I said I would, 45 minutes, and I will open it up for questions. So whatever you would like to talk about. And if I've offended you by that last point, please forgive me. Yes, sir.
Did you say that man's responsibility is denying himself?
Yes, I said that we live in a culture which encourages young men to just do whatever they feel like doing. And what that has led to is lots of young men who are utterly irresponsible, who don't really live for anything except their own pleasures. Yeah, they may have a job, they may be bright, they may get a good degree, but basically they're living an utterly self-centered life. Biblical discipleship calls us to deny ourselves. Not in the sense of saying I'm worthless, that's not what the Bible ever means by that statement, but to put God first and not myself, and to put other people first and not myself. I mean, we all know that, you know, I've been happily married for almost 45 years, and the heart of marriage is thinking more highly of my dear wife Vicky than I think of myself, of denying myself for her every day. I mean, that's what marriage is about. That's what having children is about. That's what serving as a pastor is about. That's what life is about. That's what friendship is about. That's what being a Christian is about thinking more highly of others than I think of myself. That is the mind of Christ, as Paul says in Philippians 2, and our culture teaches us precisely the opposite, to think more highly of myself than anybody else, and to do whatever I want to for myself. And Jesus calls me to something radically different. And we need to proclaim that and get people excited about it, not pussyfoot around it. And I think that's what we've done in telling people the gospel is another way of personal fulfillment, which of course it is. But if we focus on that without putting before people the challenge to discipleship, to take up that cross, to deny themselves, to put other people first, to live a life of service, to actually count the cost of being a Christian, you know, this is something worth living for and worth dying for, then we haven't actually proclaimed the Christian life to people. And in this cultural setting, I think it would actually really get guys on fire. You know, they need to get fired up. You know, they're bored to death. I see young men all the time whose lives are just, you know, they're slack-shouldered, not in simply physically, but mentally and emotionally and in terms of their wills, and they just need to start living with some passion. The gospel gives us the most possible strong base to live with passion. And so I would encourage all of you preaching and teaching, you know, just start, instead of beating around this issue, just come to it direct, even if it just startles people. You know, take up your cross, deny yourself, follow Jesus. This is worth giving your life, everything you've got for. You just stop thinking about. You know, I ask parents this question. If I were to ask your children, what do your parents want for you? What would they say? Now, Christian parents, I mean, would they say they want me to get a great education? They want me to develop my gifts. They want me to get a good job. They want me to be financially secure. They want me to be fulfilled. Would they say they want me to love Jesus and to seek the kingdom of God and God's righteousness? And they want me to follow Christ no matter what it costs me? I mean, what would they say? And I will tell you, there are very few Christian families in which the children would say, if you ask them directly, that's what my parents want for me. We have bought in what we, for all of you who are parents, I'd say, what? I mean, I've got 3 sons and 9 grandchildren now, 8 little grandsons and 1 granddaughter. You know, what are they being taught? You know, what is going to be the passion of their hearts as they grow up? Is it to follow Christ and to serve him? Or is it to get the best education and to get the best job and to make the most money and to be the most secure people? Well, no, that's not a biblical goal. And we really need to ask, well, what are we communicating to our kids? What do we want them to be? You know, I hope it does. I intend to shake them up. You know, it's.
I know it's very late
for you to be asking me questions here. It's almost 10 o'clock. So, yes, sir. That would take a little while to answer, but I'll simply say this. I remember the first time I heard Francis Schaeffer preach, it was absolutely clear he was talking about truth. Not because he was being philosophical or anything, in his sermons he wasn't, but he was just very clear, always. You know, these are events that happened in history. We're talking about the birth of Jesus, the death of Jesus, the resurrection of Jesus. This isn't a fairy story. This is the truth. So this is the truth about the world in which we live. So we're relating. It's a question of relating. You know, whenever we proclaim God's word, we're communicating wherever we can. You know, what this text is addressing is who we are as human beings, the way God has made us, the way all human beings are in this world. This is who we are. This is the truth. This text about our brokenness, our sin, this is the reality of the whole human race. This isn't a religious idea. This is the nature of all human beings in this world, so that we're constantly addressing that issue of truth and that issue of historical reality, and so that people are really getting it. When I was a pastor in England for many, many years, once a month we would have a sermon that was basically was on the Sunday. We encouraged everybody, especially the kids, to bring their friends. And I would preach a sermon which was a dialogue with the children. And they would stay where they were with their parents rather than all coming up the front. But the whole sermon, not just the kind of children's moment, but the whole sermon was addressed so that any kid of 5 years old and above could understand it. But I would take very serious issues like, who is God? Who are we? What's our problem? Where's history going? How are we supposed to live? And I always start by asking the kids, what do your friends say about this? What does God's word say about this? And to preach such a sermon, you had to be much better prepared than if you've just simply got a text in front of you, because you've got to imagine where these kids might go. You know, so you thought a lot about it. But I would say they were the best sermons we had, for the adults as well as the kids, because for all the children, it constantly had the effect of sharpening in their minds the distinction between what the culture around them was saying about human life and about the world and about Jesus and about God and about how we're supposed to be living and what God says about what the truth is. And I think the parents found it the most helpful sermons, because it was constantly, for them, building, if you like, a Christian worldview, so that it became deeply a part of the way they thought about their lives. And it enabled them to talk to their friends at work. So it was constantly bringing the world of the culture up against the truth of God's word, so that people's Christian faith wasn't kept in a separate compartment. And they were very simple sermons, because their five-year-old had to be able to understand them. But I think for the parents, they were the most profound sermons. And so I would say that's one issue, is that we've got to be constantly, in whatever way we can, addressing this issue of truth. And of also constantly upholding You know, the beauty of what God has done for us in Christ against the hopelessness of the cultural setting in which we live. So here's this wonderful story which should ravish the human heart of what God has done for us, what Dorothy Sayers calls, this is the greatest drama imaginable, you know, what the Lord has done to redeem us. And to try to teach it in such a way that people get really excited about it. You know, we're living in a culture which has no answers, and here's this wonderful resolution. Sitting in the airport today in Christchurch, there was a man sitting on the other side of the table. I was working on this lecture, and this lecture tomorrow night on Is God a Misogynist, and the things Travis wants me to do this weekend. And there was this young man sitting across me opposite the table, and he was listening to a lecture on the origin and future of the universe on his computer. It was absolutely fascinating, and I couldn't help, you know, hearing it, because it was just right there, you know, just like it was coming out of my computer, because our computers were touching each other here, so it was just right in front of me. And you know, I tried not to listen. You know, it's rude to listen to other people's things, but I couldn't help it. And then another young man came down and started talking to him. It turned out to be his brother. And then they started talking about how one of their aunts had made her views known about courtship and marriage. And they were sort of traditional Christian views, and how very strange and different this was, but how courageous she was. And I just couldn't stop, and I said, I'm so sorry, you know, I can't help eavesdropping, and I know it's very rude, but I'm just so interested in what you're saying. And then we had a wonderful conversation for about an hour and a half, and, you know, basically what I was trying to say was, hey, you listen to this lecture, which basically says the universe is going to end in nothing. You know, the sun will die, and the human race will die out, and, you know, there is no future. Everything will return to darkness, and it will be as if we never existed. And, you know, and I said, I really don't believe that. And then we just had a wonderful conversation about the gospel, and they were very interested, and wrote down a couple of books to go away and read, and asked me whether I'd written anything, and what would I suggest he read. And it was so, I gave him my email address, and I said, ask me any question you like, you know, that comes up out of these things you're going to read. And he said, I will read them, you know. So, but for him, it was, he never heard anybody saying that there is actually a hopeful account of life in this world. That was a completely new idea. And so communicating that to people, and communicating the wonder of forgiveness. I mean, we, our churches and our culture are filled with people who are just overwhelmed by the brokenness of their lives. You know, my dad became a believer 6 weeks before he died of cancer at the age of 75. And when he finally understood what Christ had done, his response was, how can a worm accept that? I mean, he was just so overwhelmed by the brokenness of his life. And now I've met my sister, you know, who came from a previous marriage in my father's life, something he kept completely hidden. I know something about why he made that statement. But we, our churches and any pastor knows, as people come into your office, if you're at all kind and sensitive, people will come and pour out the most terrible stories to you. And you know, we have a wonderful message to tell people about the forgiveness that comes to them and the renewal and restoration in Christ. And to speak that with some passion. And then, you know, this call to discipleship, and to make that exciting to people. We're not teaching moralism, and we're not teaching legalism. You know, we've got this passionate calling to radical discipleship, which the New Testament makes. And so, yeah, I mean, that's a very brief answer to your question, how are we going to preach this truth? And I think, like these two young men I spoke to today, it was utterly, I mean, they never conceived that there was anybody out there who believed anything like what I was saying. But they were very interested. And we needn't be afraid of people. You just have to take your courage. I mean, I just find I've got to say something. I just can't sit here any longer with a good conscience and not say something. That, we need to stop. No. Thank you, Peter.
Thank you, brother. Yes, we're very grateful, Jerram, for you coming to us this evening. I just want to let you know of other opportunities to hear Jerram while he's in New Zealand. Tomorrow night, he's speaking on the subject, Is God a Misogynist? A misogynist is someone who hates women, or doesn't like women, or has a distaste or dislike for women. Is God prejudiced against women? So that's going to be held at City Presbyterian Church in Karanga Happy Road, 283 Karanga Happy Road, Samar House. That's the church that Pastor Travis Scott pastors. And this weekend, Jerram is speaking on Friday night and Saturday, also at City Presbyterian in Karanga Happy Road, on faith and work. What does it mean to profess faith in Christ while pursuing our various professions? What does it mean to follow Christ in the 9-to-5 of life? So you're welcome to come and hear Jerram on those additional occasions. Thank you, brother.
Thank you.
Let me just pray and we'll be dismissed. Father God, we thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ and for the gospel he so wonderfully proclaimed and for the Holy Spirit that seals it to our hearts and guarantees us to that day of redemption. We thank you, Father, that you have placed us here in New Zealand at this time, and we ask that you would help us to examine our hearts and to grow in wisdom and love and kindness and gentleness to all those we know in our lives that do not know you. We ask, Father, you'd be willing to make us instruments in your hands for the salvation of many. We thank you for tonight, and we ask you continue to bless Jerram while he continues here with us in New Zealand. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you.